there is another aspect that we have to look at regarding this book. And that is, this is the book by Lee M. McDonald on the formation of the Christian Biblical Canon, which I said, no, the deformation of the already formed Biblical Canon is really what is at stake here. And so all the studies, whether it is the Dead Sea Scrolls or whether it's the pseudepigrapha or the apocrypha, they all deal with the deformation of the Biblical Canon. It's paraphrase, biblical paraphrases. It is para-biblical texts. Para means next to, means it's not the real biblical Bible. It's para-biblical texts. And you have it at the Dead Sea Scrolls. Many para-biblical texts, which means they were taking the Bible and they used it for educational, liturgical purposes, didactical purposes, educational purposes and other purposes. And so they added, omitted and cut and paste the biblical text just the way they wanted. And these are the things that the scholars unfortunately took too seriously and said, no, it's not a parabiblical text, it's a second canon. It's a canon that's just shorter. No, sir. That's not what the case is. And how do we know that? Well, I will tell you how. There is a test that you need to carry out in order to find out whether this is an omission or an addition of the already existing canon of that time. Which scholars didn't do? Toff didn't do it. James Saunders didn't do it. Furtwein, Fernandes. None of these scholars of the textual criticism did it. They did not. And that is, they should have taken P.M. Fraser's book, Ptolemaic Alexandria, two volumes, in which, especially volume two, with the footnotes, the endnotes, volume two dealt with citing the original Greek in detail of the scholarship, listen to me, the scholarship quality at Alexandria, Ptolemaic Alexandria, in which he discussed the various librarians that were involved at Alexandria, and then he mentioned them one by one, and he indicated that by the time of Antiochus Epiphanes and after, the quality, listen to me, the quality of the Iliad and the Odussee by Homer dropped because things were added and omitted. Wow. Okay. Yes, 130 AD. Suddenly, the Iliad and the Odussee has a big problem. And so, this is then a very important factor for us to discuss the formation of the biblical canon, because the rabbis that came, the 71 rabbis that came to help translate the Septuagint, did it for a specific purpose to prevent that the fatal, low quality scholarship of Alexandria causes the Bible to be translated in a book that is not very kosher. So therefore, they, with very care, they translated it almost literally. Well, what happened? Well, after 130, the copyists added and omitted with Homer. So why didn't they do the same with the Septuagint? Yes, they did. What was originally written in very good literal Greek translation in 287 BC, in Ptolemaic times. Later, the Alexandrian librarians allowed omissions, additions, shortcuts, and all kinds of abbreviations to be done to the book of Jeremiah, the book of Kings, you name it, Samuel, Psalms, there's even an extra psalm that James Sanders published. So when you come to this this period, you need to see that there was a deformation of the biblical canon in Greek. And so what survived in the Byzantine times is not the good one that was originally written to 87, but this deformed, shortened, abbreviated, lengthened one, paraphrased one, with added liturgical, like Daniel 3, long the addition in Daniel 3 in the Greek and other languages, translations following the Greek, was the Byzantine manuscript is the corrupt one. Yes, the one that survived is the corrupt one. The one that Constantine insisted made me 50 copies of the Old Testament in Greek very, very fast. And he used the word fast, speedy, speedy delivery. Constantine wanted it around about 350 AD. And so the Codex Alexandrinus, Vaticanus, Sinaiticus, these are remnants of Constantine's fast. Copy it for me fast. That's why there are so many differences, so many problems, so many variants among themselves. Hundreds, if not thousands of them. And so you can almost say not every phrase is even the same. And so that's not with Daniel, 4-key Daniel A. That's not with, compared to Codex Aleppo, 1008 AD. No, sir. The Christian fathers, transmitted the New Testament Septuagint in a horrible condition. And so much so, there were constant complaints. Afrikaners complained about the condition of the origin, about the condition of the Septuagint. They complained. They said they were church fathers that complained about this terrible condition of the Septuagint, that they should kind of appease the Jews to give them better manuscripts to translate more properly the Greek. And so that's why Jerome thought the old Latin, he has to improve it. But sometimes he improved it and sometimes he created it worse than the what it was originally. Even Jerome were not always using the best manuscripts. And so coming back to this aspect of the biblical canon then, and the problems of the good quality canon of the Septuagint during the Second Temple period is an aspect that none of the scholars, Torf didn't study it, P.M. Fraser, Sanders didn't, McDonald didn't. So this aspect is very important in the discussion of the degenerative condition of the quality of transmission of biblical material during Second Temple period and during the Church Fathers and their times. Now you have an idea why the biblical canon was inspired by the Holy Spirit. The moment they were written, they were a canon of the Bible. One Bible, not multiplicity like Torf is telling everybody, and how that everybody is teaching at the different theological seminaries for a long time now. It's about time that we return to the Word of God as it is. Thanks.